Good morning.
My name is Bahman Mirshab. I'm Dean, College of Management. Welcome to the first speaker-to-speaker event of this year. Before I introduce our president, I would like to ask Ms. Mina Gina to make an announcement on an event which is open to everybody, and you may be interested in attending that event. Mina, go ahead, please.
Hi, we have an event that is coming on November 3rd. From 12 noon in room M218 in Buell Management Building. And it will be presented by a guest from CIA. And the title is Why People Spy. If you need more information, please stop by after the meeting and we will provide you the room number and other information as you need them. Thank you.
It's open to public, free of charge. You can bring your colleagues from where you work. It's my pleasure now to introduce to you our president, President Virender Madgill. Dr. Madgill.
Thank you. Good morning. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to sincerely welcome you for your participation in this endeavor because the lecture today addresses many of us in different ways. Some of us need that approach to advance our companies and universities and schools and colleges. Others learn how to do it, so we're looking forward to that. But I learned that many of our colleagues in the audience are new. Some have not been here before. So for them, with your permission, I'd like to spend a minute about telling them who we are and what we do. We started in 1932 in Henry Ford's and Edsel Ford's Model T plant in Highland Park in Detroit on Woodward. And the idea of starting a new institution, we were called Lawrence Institute of Technology at that time, LIT, because Henry Ford wanted an institution that works and acts differently than what we had at that time. It was Great Depression. He needed workforce that can turn education into products. So there came the idea of theory and practice, which is our logo in our seal, that students who learn anything in class, laboratory, or studio, they must practice it. And therefore, moving forward, fast forward, during World War II, the arsenal for democracy, our graduates not only build cars, but they stopped building cars and made tanks, warplanes, fighters, and all the arsenal for democracy to win the World War II. Many of those men were Lawrence Tech graduates. Coming today, we moved here in 1955. We have four colleges, engineering, architecture and design, College of Management, that is the host for this gathering, and College of Arts and Sciences. Just next door, we have a building. If you have a chance, please go visit. Just walk around next door to this, called Taubman Complex. This building was featured in the National Design Magazine last week. Because of its very different design. You will appreciate that when you buy that. But we were very grateful for the two former students who funded that building. Being private, we get no state subsidy. So we rely on our graduates, if they're successful, which all of them are, to help us create facility that we need. So we got $20 million from Steve Ballmer, the CEO of Microsoft, who now bought Clippers for $2 billion. So he was very kind to give us $20 million to set up the STEM Center. And we got $11 million from Mr. Taubman, who initiated this project called Taubman Complex. Mr. Taubman has done other, helped for us in some other buildings as well, both for our students. Taubman actually even taught courses in real estate on this campus after he retired. There are many other graduates who have been transformative, impactful in our community and in this country. So we're very proud of that. 90% of our students have jobs before they actually finish their program. And it is because of the reputation that our students actually know what they need to do after they graduate. And the company don't have to reinvest in them, in training them. So with your advocacy, your experience on the campus, and we are so proud to host these meetings, executive to executive, and thank to Plan Moran for their sponsorship, so that we can bring the community together and think about things that are of common interest to all of us. So I'm very grateful you're here and look forward to an exciting lecture, and hope that you will come visit again because these are series that continue for a long time. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Well, thank you. Oh, there you are. Hey, Al, how are you? Good. Welcome and to our first session of our executive here at Lawrence Tech, sponsored by Plant Moran. I have the pleasure today of introducing our speaker, Nina Holden. I think you're going to find her really interesting. After graduating with a communications degree from DePaul University, she stayed in Chicago and went into a corporate advertising position. And it wasn't long, she decided that wasn't the career for her. So she was from Michigan, grew up in Detroit. So she returned in 1998 to begin her fundraising career at COTS. And she there was the marketing manager and a capital fundraiser. 2 years later, she left COTS and she went to Vista Maria. There she was chief development officer for 4 years. And she oversaw their first capital campaign, which was about $2.5 million over a two-year period. After those 4 years, in 2004, she moved to St. John Hospital Foundation as the chief development officer. There, she oversaw a $30 million capital campaign. She also oversaw major gifts there, corporate and foundation fundraising for all seven hospitals within the St. John Providence Health System. Then in 2007, she moved to her current role as Vice President of Institutional Advancement at the College for Creative Studies. There, she oversaw a campaign for $58 million for the A. Alfred Taubman Center for Design Education. In addition, she's also in charge of their annual fundraiser, which is the Detroit International Wine Auction, that raises in excess of $3 million per year. And then one item that I think everybody should be aware of, that next week, or actually 2 weeks, Nina is going to be awarded the John S. Lohr Award for Outstanding Fundraising Executive at the upcoming National Philanthropy Day meeting, which will be taking place down at Cobo Hall on November 10th. And she's very excited about that award because that's an award that you're nominated and voted upon by your peers. So with that, if you would help me in welcoming Nina Holden. And also, just thank you to Lawrence Tech. We have a little gift for you.
Thank you.
We'll take it back if it's not good, though. Just let you know.
Sure, it'll be good. Thanks, John. Good morning. So I'm kind of hoping we can have a dialogue this morning. I've prepared some thoughts to share with you, but I think it would be nice just to talk and to share some ideas. And if you don't mind, I'd love to start just by understanding a little bit about who's in the audience and what your backgrounds are. So can you tell me if you're a fundraiser? Fundraising people. Okay, lots of fundraisers. Nonprofit executive administrator, maybe? Okay, so you guys are CFOs, executive director types. Excellent. Probably left out some big category, but that just gives me a little perspective. And I try to kind of tailor my remarks to both the fundraisers and the executives. But again, just having a dialogue, I think, would be great. And I always find myself learning from who I'm talking to, not just, you know, making a presentation. So John kind of gave you a little bit of background about me. I'm a Detroiter. I grew up in Lafayette Park downtown and was really part of a fabric of a very community-centric neighborhood and family. And that's really, I think, where my love for fundraising and philanthropy began was, you know, in my childhood. And, you know, I remember I was a candy striper down at Hutzel Hospital when I was a kid. And, you know, those kind of experiences are formative experiences. And those of us that are fortunate enough to have parents that volunteer or donate, and it just kind of helps you understand the importance of the career of fundraising. So I left Detroit, as John said. I went to DePaul University in Chicago, got a degree in communications, saw myself maybe going into journalism, ended up in advertising, you know, through internships. I worked for J. Walter Thompson Advertising in Chicago on some big international brands like Kraft and 7-Eleven, and had the opportunity after several years to go over to J. Walter Thompson's Milan, Italy office and worked in Milan again on some big global brands. And it was really great formative experience, both in kind of business as well as in obviously communications and marketing. But I really felt like something was missing, as I'm sure many of you have had that feeling in nonprofit work. You feel like, you know, you want to make a difference, and I felt that way too. And so I did a lot of soul searching about how my skill set and my interests could apply to other careers, and really found that it was quite a natural fit to be a fundraiser. And so I took the leap and came home from Europe back when it was not a trendy thing to do, 20 years ago, getting old. And started working in a nonprofit. And so, as John mentioned, I started my career at COTS, the Coalition on Temporary Shelter, one of our most beloved, I think, nonprofits in the city. And my title was marketing manager, but essentially it's a teeny tiny organization with a teeny tiny development shop. And so we all kind of did a little bit of everything. And you know, in this profession, I think it's really a benefit to do some work in smaller shops because it gives you the exposure to the full gamut of development. You know, what is it, what does it mean to have an annual fund? How do you handle events? Where do corporations and foundations fit in? How do you work with an executive director or president? What's the role of the board? So in a small shop, you know, fundraisers really get exposed to all of those things and then have the opportunity to kind of decide which of those areas, you know, you're most successful at, interested in, and kind of grow from there. And so I really only spent a couple years at COTS because I really felt the need to grow. And I was recruited to Vista Maria, just a slightly larger nonprofit. It's a social service agency for abused and neglected girls in Dearborn Heights. And I spent 4 years there as chief development officer. So in that shop, I was kind of running the very small development operation, working directly with the executive director on a daily basis, and the board of trustees. And that was my first exposure to campaign fundraising, as John said. And we did a very small campaign, $2.5 million, which at that time for that organization felt like a huge campaign because they had never done a campaign before. And so, and really it was, you know, kind of, I'll talk a lot about campaigns a little bit later, but the same kind of structure and approach to a $50 million campaign, just on a much smaller scale. So how do you recruit the right leadership? How do you find those lead gifts? When's the right time to go public? So that was a really terrific experience, and I really enjoyed it. And then after 4 years, I was recruited to St. John Hospital Foundation. So I was saying earlier in the lobby, you know, one of the challenges to being a fundraiser is there's not a lot of professional training, really, to go into this career path. I mean, you can go to the Indiana School of Philanthropy, or you can take classes here and there, or you can get a degree in public health. But I have found that the best way to really learn about fundraising is to have that experience on a larger fundraising team that has a group of more seasoned professionals, that has an established major gifts program. And so those would be here, the colleges and universities, essentially, some of our larger cultural institutions. At St. John Health Foundation, I was fortunate to move into a chief development officer role, even though I really had only run a small shop. But on a pretty significant team, we had about 40 people across the region. So we had a much more disciplined approach about prospect management. You know, we all had portfolios of prospects. We had a campaign that we were working on. We were recruiting a new board. And particularly that it started with board recruitment was a great experience. So that, you know, St. John at the time had divided each of their hospitals, and each hospital foundation had its own board. And so I was involved in recruiting the board for the hospital foundation. And so we had basically, you know, we could handpick the dream leaders that we wanted from that community. And so it was a wonderful experience. And then we raised $30 million for a patient tower, and I'll tell you some stories about that. But again, the exposure to those more seasoned fundraisers was a great education for me, and is what prepared me to go on to my current role, which is Vice President for Advancement at the College for Creative Studies. I've got a couple colleagues and a former colleague in the audience today. So when I took this position almost 9 years ago, I guess it was, I was the seventh Vice President of Advancement under our current president. So people were kind of saying, like, ooh, careful. What are you doing? That guy's difficult. but it's really been a great fit for me. And I'm going to talk a lot about fit, both for the fundraisers in the audience and for the people that hire fundraisers in the audience, because it really is all about figuring out what inspires you and fitting into the team that is the right fit for you, that I think makes fundraisers and probably people in any position successful. So been at CCS, as I said, for about 9 years. We've raised almost $90 million during that time, including $58 million of a capital campaign that we launched the summer of 2008, which was a horrible time to launch a capital campaign because of the economy, but actually it ended up being a great time for us to have kind of good news in Detroit. And we found that that really interested donors, and it ended up being very successful. So I'll tell more about that. But I have a great team of about 20 folks that work with me now in the advancement office. Half of those people are marketing and PR people, communications people, and I do want to talk about the relationship between development and communications. So it's really, again, a pretty small fundraising team, but we have a very masterful fundraiser as a president, and that helps a lot. He's very involved. He's kind of our chief fundraiser, or he thinks he is. And And a very, very engaged board of trustees that is both very generous and also very active in soliciting and guiding our fundraising. So, so that's kind of a little background on me. So, you know, fit, as I mentioned, I think is kind of 90% of certainly my success, probably a lot of your success. You know, for me, I've always been passionate about the city of Detroit. I've always been passionate about trying to advance the rebirth of Detroit. I've been passionate about kids in Detroit. You know, I was always familiar with CCS. I took classes there as a kid. I'm not an artist. I mean, just like children's classes. But I knew that it was an institution that has a pretty big impact on what happens in downtown Detroit. And I think beyond fit of the mission, there's also kind of how you fit into a team of an organization. So, you know, these are kind of thoughts that I put together about, you know, when you're looking at working someplace or when you're looking at hiring a fundraiser, you know, what's the strategic plan of the institution? What's the vision of the institution? Is that inspiring to you? When you're talking to someone to bring onto the team, do you see that that person lights up because it's something that's really compelling? Because they're not going to be able to sell, you know, what you're doing if that's not in their heart. And I know that sounds corny, but that really is at the core of, you know, good fundraising and philanthropy. What's the history of the organization? Is that important to you? Can you relate to it? What's the trajectory of the organization? Do you see it being important in the future of your community, in the future of your own life? Is it making a difference in the people it's serving? I mean, I feel like a lot of our organizations in Detroit are fortunate because a lot of us can say yes to this, because it's just kind of the community that Detroit is. But you also have to consider it personally as well. I mean, there are certain organizations, if you think about, could I go work at XYZ, that I think I could never work there. I mean, I wouldn't be happy, you know? So that's a big part of success. Certainly your fit with the leadership of the institution, or conversely, the leaders fit with your fundraisers. Do you trust each other? Does the leader consider the fundraising chief to be really at the table of what the institution is doing. So I've worked at organizations where development is kind of on the side, and you know, you come in and you do your events and you have your goals, and that's fine. Versus organizations where your chief development officer or vice president is at the table with the other vice presidents of the institution. So there are certainly some drawbacks to that. One being, there are a lot of meetings where a lot of time is spent on things that don't relate to development, where you're going like, I should be doing this, I should be out talking to that person, I should be finishing this solicitation, you know, whatever it is. But I think it's really important that it's acknowledged that development is a core part of any nonprofit organization. And so to have the development people at the table is really critical. Also, you never know when your development person is going to have an idea about some boring facility thing that you're talking about that they might have a donor that would want to fund, or that we could put a certain spin on it and make it really compelling for fundraising. And so I just think that that's, you know, really the most effective partnership of fundraising, is to kind of be at the table. And also with the board of trustees, you know, I think that there are executive directors and presidents that are very protective of their boards, and you've all worked long and hard at developing those relationships, and you want to be careful about who you expose to your board. But the right fundraiser on your team is going to be able to share those relationships with their president and their executive director. It's too many people for one person to manage. And so having the right advancement person to co-manage those relationships can be really helpful to the leadership of the institution. It can also be a really strong tool for development, that the board members get to know your fundraisers and are comfortable with those people. I wanted to just mention a bit about programmatic health, because I know some of you are from smaller nonprofit organizations. And so kind of what that means to me as a fundraiser is, you know, are the programs that your agency is running relevant in the market? You know, there are a lot of, the market changes so rapidly, and it's so hard for smaller organizations to keep up with funding streams and as shifts, you know, happen in the nonprofit community. But being relevant and being agile can really make the difference in the success of a smaller, well, a larger organization too. I mean, think about, you know, so for us in art and design, we've gone from very traditional hands-on disciplines, welding and glass blowing and things like that, to the now very high-tech interactive disciplines. And you know, you have to, how do you maintain kind of those core critical programs, but also be agile enough to respond to the needs of the market and the changing world? So these are things that, you know, fundraisers should be thinking about too. And then, of course, the fiscal health of the organization. Obviously, operating expenses and ongoing needs, and I'm going to talk a little bit about my perspective on budgeting and how that should work, because I heard there are some CFOs in the audience. So fundraisers and CFOs should be best friends. I just want to say that. Okay. but also being aware of kind of the storm clouds that might be out there threatening your institution, your business. Of course, everybody wants to raise more money, but you know, there are other shifts in industries that are real threats to organizations, and how do you prepare for that? How do you build that into your strategic plan? How do you fundraise to prevent major losses, things like that? So that's just kind of a little bit of thought that I have about when you're going to work at an organization or you're hiring a fundraiser, the things you should keep in mind. This is probably really basic to folks, but these are some kind of generic examples of sources of revenue for different types of organizations: a social service agency, a cultural organization, higher education. The point I wanted to make with these pie charts, well, I guess 2 points. The first one is that generally the majority of an institution's revenue does not come from fundraising. Generally, there's a fee for service in cultural organizations, earned income, which is memberships and ticket sales and things like that. In higher education, obviously, tuition is the majority of your revenue. A lot of times, those streams are somewhat fixed. They might grow slightly every year. They don't generally change dramatically year after year. Where fundraising, I do feel that there are opportunities to make significant shifts in what you're bringing in, whether you're going into a campaign or you have some new exciting project to fund. Of course, the healthiest organizations have a mix, a very kind of healthy, balanced mix of revenue streams. So I kind of wanted to just put this out there as a fundraiser, you should be thinking about this and where do you fit? And, you know, I've certainly watched some friends of mine go to organizations that were extremely challenged fiscally and think that fundraising could save the organization, and it really cannot. You know, and if leadership is expecting fundraising or a new fundraiser to come in and change your whole kind of financial makeup or save you, it's probably not going to be successful. But certainly we can play a key role. So, institutional capacity for fundraising. I wanted to talk a little bit about capacity of the board and what that means to me. So we always hear this give and get term. And I never think you should forgive giving for getting. I think that every board member of every organization should give to the extent of their ability. And, you know, I'm at my organization, some of those gifts are huge. I'm on boards or volunteer in organizations where some of those gifts are small. It doesn't matter. The board should give 100%. But I also think that good board members need to be educated on the power of getting. And I don't know if I really even love the term getting. Introducing the right prospects to their organization. And it's really the fundraiser's key role as strategist to help their board members understand which relationships can really have an impact on that organization and what are the right ways to introduce those people. And of course, building relationships take time, and just because board member A has a relationship with rich person A, that doesn't mean that bring them to an event and then ask them for $1 million. That usually doesn't work. We've tried that. It doesn't work. but, you know, developing the strategy to engage those folks that your board can introduce you with can be a really key element of success for your development operation and your fundraisers. So, and it's also a lot of fun, and it makes board members feel good, you know, when they brought their friend who they thought might be interested, and then their friend really is excited, and then there ends up being a big gift, you know, so that it, and then it kind of has a ripple effect. Of course, one of the challenges to that, particularly in smaller organizations, is if you don't have any trustees that have their own capacity, and you're trying to build those boards or those relationships with wealthy people, it can be very difficult. And when I was at Vista Maria, we talked all the time about how do we find that angel? We were always looking for, if we just had the one angel who would come on the board, it's usually a big name. I was laughing in my head yesterday when I was thinking about this stuff. Back then, it was always Oprah. How can we get to Oprah? Do you guys remember that era? It's like everyone wanted, if we could just get Oprah. Right. But it can be really hard. You can have a very dedicated, well-meaning board that's very active and committed that has no financial capacity and no very few wealthy people, and that's tough. So you're always looking for that angel, you know. Be interested in any stories maybe at the end that anyone has to share about that. Who's in your existing donor base? You know, there's usually some really good folks in that donor base if you can figure out how to find them. And a lot of times it's not obvious. And so are your fundraisers paying attention to the signs? You know, are they watching as those gifts come in? Are they looking at the addresses? Are they paying attention at the events? Are they spending time out of their offices? I know it makes a lot of nonprofit leaders nervous when, like, the office is not full. I had a boss that, you know, I had to leave my calendar on my door so that this, obviously this was before we had iPhones. I had to leave my calendar on my door so if he walked through the development department, he wouldn't think we were all, you know, at the beach or the bar more likely, but, right. But we cannot raise a ton of money sitting behind our desks and, you know, how do you figure out who's in your donor base that you need to be getting to know that could be helping you get to those bigger gifts. And also, of course, the volunteers, you know, the docent at the museum. What's her story? What's her connection? What's her capacity? The folks that come in and serve lunch at the shelter. I mean, you never know, you know, taking a minute, having development people that take the time to talk to people, that's really how you identify some of those great opportunities. And then conversely, your president, your executive director, even your CFOs and your other admin, you know, will they take the time, particularly, I guess, your president, your executive director, to prioritize fundraising? You should be having weekly meetings with your fundraisers. You know, there are some colleagues of mine that haven't met with their executive directors or presidents in weeks and weeks, or they would meet once a month. It's like, okay, well then that means that he or she is not spending that much time on development. And it's your job as the fundraiser to make sure that the leader of your organization is committed to fundraising. Will they talk to people? You know, you gotta drag them out to events, or, you know, not just every random thing, but the ones where there are key prospects for you, the ones where, you know, they could be making some of those connections, because donors want to talk to leadership. I mean, you know, the fundraisers are fine and they'll talk to us for a while, but after a certain point, they want to talk to leadership. And then, of course, educating your presidents and executive directors, if they don't have the experience, about how to pitch. And I know that's kind of a harsh word, but, you know, what is your elevator speech? How what's the compelling spin that they're putting on your institution? Even if what they're worried about are those storm clouds, how do you put the spin on that that helps donors understand the role they could play or an impactful gift could play on making a difference there? And then closing, of course, and that's, you know, another art for all of us, is how do you, once you put it out there, how do you get the gift? Development team, and one of my colleagues reminded me yesterday to talk about leveraging the strengths of your development team. So what that means to me is, on mid-size and smaller teams, you all have specific positions. I'm the major gifts officer, I'm the events director, but you also all have specific strengths. And so as the leader of a development team, to understand, you know, who's your person that you can throw in front of anyone at any time that can talk to that person? Who's your person that can organize data in a way to put a compelling proposal together? You know, and sometimes the strengths don't always match exactly the titles. And I think it's really healthy for a development team to be a little bit fluid like that. You know, the largest shop I've ever worked in, as I mentioned, is the St. John Hospital shop. So that was 40 fundraisers. So I've never worked at a U of M. I've never been a part of hundreds and hundreds of fundraisers. And those teams, I think, are very competitive, and they probably have to be in order to raise those billions of dollars. But I think for smaller, mid-sized teams, I think it's really healthy to share goals. Everybody has to deliver. Everybody should know what their goal is for the year, you know, how many actions, how many visits, how many solicitations, how much money. But on our team, we usually all win. I mean, I'm just going to put it out there, knock on wood. I don't think we've had a year where we did not do well, but sometimes it's because our corporate colleague over-delivers. Sometimes it's because that event comes in huge. Sometimes we're in campaign and we get that seven, eight figure, whatever. So I just think that, you know, to me, that's the kind of culture that makes for a successful team, in my experience, leveraging strengths. Programmatic experts. So these are your department chairs, your faculty members, the folks that run your emergency shelters, the people that are working with the people that you're raising money for. And, you know, as a fundraiser or as a leader of an institution, being able to identify those folks that are really good at telling those stories can help with fundraising a lot. So you probably are all thinking of, you know, oh yeah, when I go to that person, he always can give me that story that I know is going to inspire a donor, versus like, that guy, not so much. You know, so I think it's part of the strategy, a good strategy of fundraising, for your development people to know the rest of your institution well enough so that they know who to call when that one donor is coming for a tour or when they have to go visit somebody. That's a great kind of stewardship or cultivation step before you bring in the president for the big ask. You know, it's a good tool for development folks. And again, the volunteers, kind of same comments as above. Should I take a breath? Does anyone have any thoughts they want to share? I know, it's early. So some of this I've kind of touched on, but I really feel that the key role of your head development person is chief strategist and storyteller, but first strategist. Those should probably be two separate points. You know, really great fundraisers are not the people out front necessarily. Sometimes in smaller organizations you have to be, but really great fundraisers are figuring out how to get your president or your executive director, your board members to do what you need them to do in order to raise money. And not just because you think it's a good idea, but putting together the strategies and sitting down and talking about strategies to get to those folks and to get your leadership to get to those folks. And storytelling, you have to know enough about obviously what's going on in your organization or institution to be able to tell those stories too. Setting goals. So I've been fortunate enough to be on teams where the leaders generally understand what's a good stretch goal and what's too far. And I've also been exposed to teams that try to push too hard or try to fill gaps with fundraising, and it usually doesn't work. And then, of course, everybody feels bad, especially the fundraisers. So I'll talk more about that a little bit. Building an inspiring team. So this is one that, you know, it takes some time to learn this. I mean, for all of you that are seasoned professionals in any capacity, you know, how you put together the team that does what you need them to do and how you set that culture and that expectation, how you work with your managers so that your managers are managing what needs to get done, but you're setting the vision and inspiring the team. That's a really fun part of, I think, becoming a more seasoned professional. Is that a good way to say it, seasoned? Getting older. And then key donor relationships. You know, identifying which relationships your leader needs to be managing, which relationships can be managed by other folks on your team, which relationships your president or executive director needs to own, but you still need to develop the strategies for. You know, that's all part of chief strategist, kind of, but the leader of the team really needs to, I think, drive that discussion. The role of the executive director is critical. I feel like I've said this a little bit already, but I mean, everybody knows, if you work for a nonprofit, you have to fundraise. But there have been a lot of nonprofit leaders that have not been good at this. I mean, you know, we'd never name names in town, but I can think of, you know, that one executive director you always see sitting by himself in the coffee shop. And as a fundraiser, if I walk in and see that guy there, I'm like, why is he sitting alone? He should be with the donor, you know? It's like, why is he having lunch by himself? That's weird. Because it's not, you know, they've got to really own that. As well as the board, you know, and I think it's the fundraiser's job to be very specific with their board members and trustees about what we need them to do. And of course, there are always those trustees. You know, I have one that I can think of. He's actually not a trustee, he's chair of a ancillary board. He's always coming up with some really unhelpful thing, and it takes a lot of time to manage him. And I know he wants to help, but it's like not helpful. So, you know, how do we educate board members about what is really helpful and what we need their help with? Gilda's looking at her watch. It's only been 15 minutes. I'm doing good, okay. And other volunteers as well. How can our volunteers help us? I mean, a lot of times those people want to do more too. Like, think about if there's a woman who's serving lunch at the shelter, you know, once a month forever, how compelling it could be to introduce her to a huge donor prospect. You know, I mean, so just paying attention to that stuff. Example of a structure. So here you see the vice president of advancement or chief development officer at the table with the other vice presidents. I wanted to talk a little bit about, you know, in general, whether you have a team that's big enough to have major gifts officers or and marketing and public relations people on the team or not. So this is just kind of an example of a very basic structure. Obviously, many of our structures are much bigger than this, but you know, I'll talk a little bit in the upcoming slides about that role of major gifts and whether or not you have a person or not. So, in fact, I'll talk about it right now. So, you know, how many of you are in shops that are pretty small teams of fundraisers? Just so I get a sense. Okay, a lot of you. So this is a great conversation for us to have. You know, I mean, and I would say to me that means six people or less on your development team. A lot of time teams like that don't have major gift officers. And, you know, they also don't have kind of a culture of major gift fundraising. And it's really, really hard to develop that on small teams because you're so busy just responding to the day-to-day stuff. You know, if you have an event, the whole team is consumed by it. If you're working on a big grant, if you know, there's always something that's more pressing than, you know, how do I just sit down and identify that one donor from my donor base and develop a strategy. You know, it doesn't ever seem like there's time to do that. But I think, again, it's paying attention to the signs. And, you know, I had an experience at Vista Maria, and I think I put this someplace later in the presentation, but I'll skip it later, where there was a donor who was a corporate business owner who made a $2,000 gift. So at a social service agency, a lot of times that's a pretty good size gift, and I noticed it. And I called him and I said, would you like to come out for a tour? And he said, sure. And he came for a tour, and it turned out, you know, he had grown up in the area, and it was, the mission was something that was interesting to him. And after that, you know, he made kind of another more significant gift, not huge, you know, maybe a $10,000 gift to an event. I can't remember specifically, but then he put the organization in his will and he made $1 million commitment. And so the point is we had no major gift officer, but you have to pay attention to the signs. And that was a sign. I mean, even wealthy people are not going to send you $2,000 if they don't care. I mean, actually, they probably won't send you $500 if they don't care. So, you know, forcing yourself to make that phone call or write that personal note or invite them for a tour can really lead to a much bigger gift if you take the time. Of course, if you have a team with major gift officers, you know, that's one of the roles of a major gift officer, not only to manage your existing donors, but to do that prospecting, to do that digging, you know, I think that the best traits of good major gift officers are people who are super curious, almost even nosy. How did that person, you know, I'm going to Google them and look at, you know, that, because that's what uncovers useful information a lot of times. And also kind of being somewhat entrepreneurial. Hospitals, healthcare systems, University of Michigan and big universities have the luxury of having kind of built-in donor bases, grateful patients, alumni with lots of money, things like that. Great if someone hands you your list of prospects, like you're on a sales team and that's the kind of organization you work for, then you know what you have to do with that. But if you don't, being entrepreneurial enough to think about, you know, okay, this guy came to this event and he spent $1,000 and I think he's interested in this program. What's the right person to introduce him to? How do I get, you know, so that entrepreneurial mindset. I've also seen examples of smaller shops that budget the money to hire a major gift officer and it's not successful because it's just, the organization just isn't ready for it. You know, and so then you have this poor major gift officer that's trying to get people's attention and trying to find prospects, and the culture just isn't there yet. So it's kind of a tricky balance knowing where you are on that continuum for smaller shops. Culture I talked a little bit about, but I wanted to also mention the importance of longevity. I think it's very acceptable in the development profession for fundraisers to move around every, I would say 3 to 4 years is kind of our magic number. And if you're at an organization that's not the right fit for you, that makes sense to me. But I also think that it does a disservice to our profession to have so much moving around, because donors don't typically move around. They typically are committed to an organization that they care about. And so they care about those long-term relationships that they develop with people there. And I can really see a difference in my own effectiveness now that I've been at one place for 9 years, in the conversations that I'm able to have with very important and wealthy people that I couldn't have had. I mean, I could have tried to have those conversations 5 years ago, but you know, it's you're able to be more effective, I think, if you can find the folks that are the right fit for your team so that they can develop those relationships on their own. So, I encourage that, and I'm proud of it. I mean, it's easy to move. You get calls all the time. I mean, we all do, but. So, and then I wanted to talk a little bit about the role of public relations and marketing. Again, if you're fortunate enough to have those disciplines in your development structure versus separate, and I've been in both scenarios. So right now, we're combined. So the marketing folks report to me. In higher education, they spend a lot of their time on recruitment and enrollment, marketing and communications, and so I kind of co-manage that activity with our vice president of enrollment. But, you know, your fundraisers are one of your key voices in the community. They're telling your story. Their messaging needs to be aligned with the messaging of whatever your marketing and PR people are doing, which can be really difficult at larger organizations. So I have fundraisers from larger organizations or people from larger, not really so much one, yeah. When I was at St. John, we were completely separate, but we were across the hall from each other. And so the director of marketing at that hospital and I were very intentional about, okay, here's where we are in promoting our campaign. Here's the messaging that we're going to put out there. You know, how do we align so that it's more effective communication? I personally am a proponent for, if it's possible, if it makes sense, having those functions under one umbrella. Even if marketing and PR does stuff that's not related to development, some of the time it's still, I think, good to have communications together. So, development revenue streams. So the thing I was thinking about, this again is just kind of a generic pie chart, because I thought pie charts would be good in this presentation. you know, I have to say, it's really all individual giving. This is my perspective on the pie chart. I mean, we can talk about how to break out the various percentages of which come from which bucket, but it's really all about those relationships that you have with the individuals, whether it's for their own philanthropy or for their corporate philanthropy or for the foundations that they work at. My father was a newspaper guy and became a fundraiser later in life. He did grants and foundation fundraising. And I remember a lesson that he taught me, which is that a grant should be like a marriage certificate, meaning you should already have developed the full relationship with that funder. And the grant is just the piece of paper at the end. And that's, I think, a good lesson to apply to a lot of fundraising. You know, it's really about that person, and sometimes the person represents an entity, and that entity has objectives, and then you have to think about how you fit with that. But, you know, it's kind of all about those individual relationships. Benefits and pitfalls of events. So, I mean, I remember spending years fighting against events. No more events. It's too many events. The golf outing, the car raffle. It's like, oh my God. Because they're so time-consuming, and usually the payout is not great, but mostly because it's so time-consuming for your development team. I mean, there's not a lot of time to do other, you know, major gifts or strategic stuff if you're working on events. So, but the benefit is it's that face-to-face time with your donors, right? So how do you identify what that signature event is, or one or two key events that you've got to do every year that are great opportunities that your donors believe in, that make money. Okay, if they don't make money, it's time to reevaluate. You know, I mean, so many of these events that make, no offense, $15,000 a year, I mean, it's not worth it. You know, you've got to find a different model, and I'll talk a little bit about that. But, and then cultivation and stewardship events, and those are great too, unless you're spending all your time and they're not actually leading to any follow-up solicitations and gifts. But they are a great way to meet people if you can figure out how to get people to one of your trustees' homes, or how to get them to an opening on your campus, or, you know, how to get them to the NICU to see the babies, you know, whatever it is. Corporate and foundation fundraising, these probably also should be two categories, honestly, because I think so much corporate giving now happens through events. I mean, and there are obviously significant corporate foundations that have specific objectives that they fund, but a lot of it ends up kind of being for events. And foundations always want new programs. You know, they don't want to fund operations, they want to fund something new. And that's really hard, you know, and I think there is a dialogue in the foundation community about whether or not that's really helpful to nonprofits to always want to fund the new stuff, unless if you've got something new, and then it's great, because then they'll give you the money. But again, developing those relationships, the dialogue, so that even if it's not the right time for you to ask those foundations, you know who the players are, you've kept them up to speed, so when it's time to ask. And then major and planned gifts, again, depending on the size of your shop. And, you know, the connection to annual giving, meaning, again, what gifts are coming in? Who are they from? Who's paying attention? I mean, I give my president a list of gifts every week. He looks at that list of gifts. He doesn't sign all the letters anymore. It took me a few years to get those letters away from him, because he doesn't have time. But he should know, and sometimes he recognizes people that we don't recognize. We send a report every 2 weeks. Is it every 2 weeks? Every gift that's come in by category to all of our fundraisers, to our executive leadership, just so that people are aware. It's helpful. That's a helpful tool. So how do you develop a plan to incorporate all of this stuff? And, you know, to me, the key, too, is how do you balance institutional needs, which are always, I mean, you could, needs are endless, with your staff capacity, what's realistic? How do you develop strategies by element? And then how do you budget? And again, I'm very against, you know, budgeting to the need of the institution without considering the capacity of the team or the capacity of your donors. It's just not a smart way to manage philanthropy. So this is just a really impossible to read example of, we used for years and years this very simple spreadsheet. I used it with my team in multiple organizations just to say, here's how we're, here's our plan this year. Here's how we're going to get to our goal, whether it's 50 million or 3 million or a million, whatever it is. You know, here are the key initiatives. Here's who's responsible for it in each of the objective areas. Here's the key strategy, timing, overall goal, year-to-date progress, and measurable outcome. We'll probably start using this again now that we're moving into a campaign again. I haven't used it for a couple years because, you know, my team's been together and we've kind of been doing a lot of the same things, growing it. But it's a really helpful check-in. It's a really easy tool. And I don't know, do your development shops, do you have annual plans? I'm just curious. Yeah, see, people don't have them. One, maybe. Right. So maybe you don't need them, but it does kind of help. And it also helps for your team members to see, not just hear about, but to actually see what other people are working on and what your goals are and how could I be helpful in that. I mean, it happens all the time that my major gifts officer, who's responsible for individual giving, brings in corporate sponsorships for events because that's the person that she happens to meet. So there's crossover, you know. I would encourage, you know, using something like this in whatever simple format. I mean, I believe in simple in general. You know, the lists of the hundreds of names, no, I don't think that ever works. Maybe for huge operations where you have huge teams and you have researchers and multiple database people to sort and resort and all that, but if you don't have that luxury, it's so overwhelming. You know, I always say to my fundraisers, like, who are your top three? I don't care about your 50. I mean, I do care about the 50. I want to know that they're there and they're getting queued up and what the long-term strategy is. But everybody should be thinking about, you know, who are my 90-day people? Or who are my million-dollar people? It's so much more manageable that way. And, you know, you, like, your boss is never going to be mad if you just close the $1 million gift. Or pick a number, whatever size your institution is. If you just close the $25,000 gift and you don't get to those other 30 people, I mean, you have to prioritize. So this kind of approach, really simple, I think it's a helpful tool. So I want to talk about campaigns a little bit. So people talk about long-term fundraising plans, but to me that means a campaign, because it's almost impossible to have a long-term fundraising plan. You know, we have a rolling five-year strategic plan at CCS. If you're not in a campaign, it's kind of hard to plan 3 years from now what's your goal going to be for your signature event or for foundations and corporations or whatever it is. It's just, it's not... I don't know if people have had other experiences, but to me that's difficult. To me, if you're talking about long-term fundraising, you're talking about a campaign. So I wanted to talk a little bit about kind of the two types of campaigns that are common and just my experience with those. So the first one is your kind of traditional capital campaign. And these are generally the gifts to bricks and mortar. So very specific initiative. We're building a new patient tower, or we're redeveloping this building, or, you know, whatever that may be. There's a lot of great things about capital campaigns because they're very visible, they're very tangible. They're also they can be easier for development folks because it's one ask. You've got one ask. I'm raising money for this building, and I can put your name on the auditorium, or I can put your name on, you know. So you target your asks to donors with specific interests. You're addressing a specific need. It's a traditional approach, but it does have limits. I mean, if you have a donor that cares about buying food for the soup kitchen and not about the auditorium or the patient tower or whatever it is, then there are limits. You know, I think I know I mentioned that, you know, we did have some great success with our Advancing the Creative Spirit campaign that we launched in 2008. We did have a lead gift from Mr. Taubman. The lead gift is key. We also have an extremely high capacity and generous board. So of the $58 million we raised $30 million from our trustees. So that helped a lot. Yeah, that was really great. I was like, oh, I love it here. I'm staying here forever. but it was also, you know, this was the project to take the historic Argonaut building and new center, which was General Motors' original research and design center, and renovate all, how many square feet? 100 and 200,000 square. It's huge. It's a city block. 12 stories, 11 stories, 2,000 new windows. I mean, it was a huge, it was a $160 million project, so we did 58 in philanthropy. And it was one of those kind of tipping point projects for everything that's happening in Midtown. And so a lot of the foundations in town really got behind it early, and we ended up raising probably $13 million from foundation gifts. So we had a really great base to grow from, all bricks and mortar. So there's names everywhere. And that was, you know, it was really great. And I think that it made the board feel great. And now it's this living, breathing entity, you know, on Woodward in Baltimore that it's kind of proof. So now we're looking at, we're in the silent phase of another type of campaign, which is also, I think this is like the new normal, which is the comprehensive campaign. And these are the campaigns that you hear about all of the big higher ed institutions doing, you know, where it's combined needs. So in our case, it's for scholarships and faculty and some capital and different kinds of programming. And it's a whole different beast. A lot of times these campaigns are longer in timing, so a lot of times they're maybe a 10-year campaign versus a 5-year campaign. They're ongoing campaign. Wayne State's doing it. I mean, this is how, it's the new normal. There's no break in between. You're always in this huge, gigantic campaign. So if you're a bigger organization and you have the luxury of some of those built-in prospect pools, like alumni, grateful patients, it can work. But for our smaller organizations, sometimes you need to give your donors a little break in between. So we gave them like a year off, and now we're going into this. Well, someone's going to get those gifts. I mean, you know, philanthropists are going to give money away every year, so you don't want to take too much time off, or else someone else is going to get your gift. I mean, honestly. So the comprehensive campaign, so we're just kind of wading into this now, CCS. We have a fantastic chair, Nate Forbes, who's the president and CEO or chairman of the Forbes company that owns Somerset Collection and a lot of other retail, high-end retail properties in the country, and also is partners with Dan Gilbert on all of his work downtown and all of the businesses from the Cleveland Cavaliers to everything else. Anyway, he's young, dynamic, he believes in the city. We're in our silent phase, so you haven't heard about any of this yet. So my team is learning about these comprehensive campaigns, very different from here's my building, this is my one project. And so we're just starting to have these conversations, and actually it's really great because what we're able to do is say to our donors, so here's all the stuff my institution needs. What do you like? Oh, you like you know, painting. Oh, you like students from Detroit, making sure that they get a chance to do this. Oh, you like renovating this, whatever, you know what I mean? And so it's very donor driven. So, you know, we're not announcing any leadership gifts yet, but it's pretty interesting. I think it's gonna allow a much broader participation. Our campaign for the Taubman Center, the 58 million, were probably from 100 gifts. I mean, it was a very small group. So this will probably be broader, addressing a wide range of institutional needs. Again, this is growing increasingly common due to flexibility and scope, and just that the needs of all of our organizations are so varied. You know, we don't have the luxury of like stopping and saying, okay, now we're gonna build this building and everything else will just wait. So it's pretty interesting. Does anyone have any other examples of campaigns or thoughts? I'm not going to get anyone to talk besides me. Okay, it's fine. So getting organized for a campaign, I mean, really the key is getting everyone on board strategically. Here are the needs of the institution. Here's our strategic plan. You know, here's the commitment that the leadership of the institution is going to make. And then finding that key volunteer leader. I mean, you saw how excited I was when I talked about Nate Forbes. It's because he is going to have the potential to really transform this institution. And the fact that he kind of sees that opportunity and how it relates to the bigger picture of Detroit and his own businesses and everything else going on, he's going to inspire so many of our donors and new donors to participate. So getting that right leadership. For our last campaign, it was David Fisher, the CEO of the Suburban Collection. The nature of his leadership role was very different because it was a much more focused campaign, both on our trustees and on the corporate and foundation community. He was great at that. That was his comfort zone. So it's different for every campaign and every institution. You know, when we built the patient tower at St. John Hospital on the east side, it was Jim Nicholson, longtime community resident, business owner, beloved, like nobody's gonna say no to him. You just have to find that right fit. Feasibility and planning study. So I believe in doing feasibility studies, doing planning studies. Sometimes you don't have the luxury to do that. We did not do one for the Taubman Center project because so much of the financing was already committed to in tax credits and bonds that we had to do it, and we had our lead gift. So, you know, there really wasn't, I was very nervous as a fundraiser, but I was not allowed to use the F word, feasibility study. I was like, okay. So it worked out okay, but for this campaign, we did do a planning study. We didn't call it feasibility. We called it planning, same thing, where, you know, you hire a consultant who talks to, for us, it was 50 of our biggest prospects, shared the top needs of the institution, got donor feedback and buy-in, helped us prioritize what we were going to raise money for, and kind of got a sense for what could our goal be. I was hoping for a bigger goal over a longer period of time, but I also, you know, I trust my president and my trustees, and, you know, you don't want to put yourself out there too much as a fundraiser. You know, they want to do 50 million. 50 million's good, right? So, but the planning study really helps prepare for that and get institutional buy-in. Define the goal, and then the gift chart, you know, how are we going to get there? And that's interesting too, because, you know, the traditional approach is you raise, I don't remember the percentage, is it 20% of your overall goal is from your lead gift or some huge percentage. But there are also a lot of successful campaigns that have, you know, a number of large gifts. So maybe instead of, you know, a $20 million gift, you have $4 or $5 million gift. I mean, there are other ways to structure it, and I'll talk a little bit more about that. But, you know, a planning study does help you think about, okay, who should we be asking up here? Who's got the capacity? Who's excited when they talk to us? So that was helpful. And then how do you build the case? And I don't know about all any of you. Who's done campaigns in the room? A few people, yeah. So writing the case statement. We've been writing our case statement for a year. It's actually written and printed now. It's probably as close to being done as possible. You know, the case statement is not going to get your big gifts. It's not, you know, it's not like you're going to just mail it to Oprah and then she's going to send you $50 million. But, I mean, it is, I find the case statement exercise a really great tool for the fundraising team and the president and the volunteer leadership to practice telling the story and to get the story right. And I think that's what this current campaign case statement has done for us. And I remember the last one too. So, you know, telling the story of this historic building in Detroit and renovating it and putting in a, you know, middle and high school and all of these exciting things was good. But it was really for us, you know, identifying that what that meant was we were creating this opportunity for kids in Detroit to start in middle school and go all the way up through, to be in a building with a college in it, first of all, and see that as a natural progression in their education, and to be exposed to art and design education, and then to careers in art and design, and creating that pipeline. That was like our, when we got to that phrase after working on our case statement, that was really our tipping point when people started going like, yes, that's what we want to buy, you know? So, to me, agonizing over the words can be really painful, but if it gets you to that point where you know what your compelling case is, and it should, then it's worth it. So obviously you talk about your organization, what sets you apart, what makes you unique, why you need a campaign, what can be accomplished with the funds, data, donors love data. And then the tipping point concept I mentioned. So that's the case. I think that's all I want to say about that. And then putting your gift chart together. So I used a really simple, kind of small number gift chart, but you could multiply this to any level you wanted to. But essentially the idea is, you know, you should have three prospects at least for every one gift you're trying to get at every level. Sometimes they're more or less, and also, of course, they move around. So if you have three people that you think could give you $500,000, or pick the number, you know, it could be $20 million, the one or two that don't give at that level might give you 15. So your gift chart is gonna change, it'll be fluid. But I think it's important to, it's an important roadmap, and it's important for your volunteers, your committee, to understand, like, yeah, we need X number of gifts at this level. And also, as you start having the conversations with those folks, they start thinking, like, ooh, I could be the guy at that level. You know, they really do. And, you know, you can kind of see it happening, you know. It's like, you know, we need $2-10 million gifts, so if it doesn't come from you, where do you think we're going to get it? You know, they start thinking about that. So, and I mentioned for our Argonaut campaign, you know, we got to the goal with, you know, the lead gift from Taubman, and then, you know, a huge sum of money from the board and a huge sum of money from corporations and foundations, and then probably $15 million gifts and then a bunch of smaller gifts. But School of the Art Institute of Chicago now is in a $50 million campaign, and they're at $40 million with no gifts larger than $5 million, which is crazy if you think they're in Chicago. Like, how many millionaires do they have, right? But they're doing it, you know? So the point is, yes, you should always have that big gift. But if you don't, I mean, I guess it's always possible. We're going to get the big gift, though. I can feel it. Just in case my boss sees the tape, right? He's going to get it. I'm going to develop the strategy. any thoughts about that? Anyone wants to share anything? How am I doing on time? Oh, it's 10 to 10. Look at that. Oh my God, is it 10 to 10? Excellent. Phases of a campaign: planning phase, quiet phase, public phase, celebration. So I'm happy to talk more in detail with any of you that are interested in learning more about this anytime. This is pretty common. You could probably Google it, but this is just kind of how it worked for us. Plan giving as a tool, really interesting, especially for your older and longer term donors, to talk about how much more impact a combined gift can have. A gift now in cash of a certain amount of money and then something in their estate. I mean, we're really watching a couple of our longtime beloved donors and trustees light up when they think about, you know, how much more they could do for us and how telling us now, we can celebrate them now, we can count the money now. I mean, there's just great, it's a great opportunity. And I think it used to be that, you know, plan giving is like this intimidating, you know, topic, like I'm supposed to memorize all of these different, you know, CRT, whatever, all those numbers, letters, whatever. No, that people have people they can go talk to about that. They can talk to their financial planners, they can talk to advisors, attorneys. You don't have to memorize that, but you do have to, you know, plant the seed for the fundraiser to be able to talk about the difference between a $25,000 endowed scholarship and a $500,000 endowed scholarship. That's important. Measuring success. Of course, financial, you always want to beat your goal. The number of donors and expanding those relationships is key, and the positive news that it brings for an organization. So then, good news and horror stories. I mean, can we do this part together anyway? Like, good stories and horror stories, anyone? I'll share one. So we have a trustee at CCS who was a donor, a small donor that I knew at my previous, at St. John Hospital. Actually, her family was very involved with the hospital. And she, I would see her at events and I knew she had significant wealth and she was always kind of like, ooh, she didn't want to talk to me. I was like, hey. So she happens to be an alum of CCS, and I knew that. And so when I interviewed for my job at CCS, I told our president, there's this woman that I know from St. John. This could be her thing because she's an alum. She's got huge wealth. She doesn't give much to St. John. Her family does, whatever. And long story short, we engaged her, and turned out she had a great experience at CCS, and we recruited her to the board, and she's made multiple seven-figure gifts. And we're now talking to her, knock on wood, about being one of our cornerstone gifts for this campaign. And she's in her 50s, you know, she's got great long-term potential for the organization. So again, just paying attention and finding the fit for the donor, you know, that inspires them. I don't want to talk about horror stories. Okay. Should we do question and answers? I'm so proud I talked so long. Wow. I didn't think I'd be able to. Thanks. Yes.
What's the average contribution of your board
members? Annually? So there is a range, and we don't have, the question is, what's our annual board contribution? The chairman of the board makes a very significant, you know, a five-figure annual gift in addition to all the other gifts he makes. A lot of our trustees do a $5,000 or $10,000 gift to the annual fund, but they also sponsor our event, a lot of them at the $25,000 level. They do big, you know, campaign gifts. And we don't, again, it's not, when we recruit our trustees, we don't say, and there's a X $1,000 annual gift. But, you know, we're fortunate enough to have a board that they kind of hold each other accountable. They think that the chairman of the board looks at the list and knows, like, who's giving and who's not giving. He really doesn't. I do, but then I just ask more, so. Oh. Okay. Oh, yeah. I have a question. So we have a vice president for fund development and an executive director, both of whom have, you know, the best interests of the organization at heart. But somehow the criteria for deciding who's the point person for a relationship can be a challenge. So I was just wondering if you have, like, criteria or, like, some kind of... kind of structured way of deciding that kind of thing?
Well, usually you do what your boss wants to do. That's the basic criteria. But no, I mean, that's why it's important for the executive director and the chief fundraiser to trust each other and have a good relationship, because a lot of times it is the executive director that should be kind of appear to be managing that relationship, but it's still the fundraiser's role to make sure that the strategy is on track for the gift. I'd be happy to talk more about that. I'd love to ask you a few questions that, you know, we could do that after if you want.
There's been so much talk lately about giving strategies for younger donors, this next generation of donors. And I wonder if you're changing your strategy, your ask, your approach to develop some of the millennials that are coming up from wealthy families.
Yeah. So are you referring to, just so I'm clear on the question, are you talking about kind of the next generation of wealth, or are you talking about millennials as a category?
Really both.
Both. Well, so two different answers then. I mean, the next generation of wealth is critical, and we've been very intentional about engaging the children, the adult children of our, you know, longtime supporters in the institution, putting them in board seats, putting them on committees, making sure, you know, also helping their parents to see. I mean, a lot of times, you know, the parents like that. They want to know, like, my son is going to succeed me in this role, or my daughter is really excited about this too. So just being really intentional and talking about it, you know, I think has, and we did it at St. John as well, you know, the guy that named the patient tower, his daughter was on the board. You know, it's just a way to, but, you know, involve the parents in that discussion, because they want their families to stay involved. Millennials are tricky. We have a pretty small donor base. For us, being a college, we're doing phone-a-thon calling now, and we have students calling, and I was resistant about that for years. Even though I myself was a phone-a-thon caller in college, I just feel like it's an intrusive way to talk to people, but it does work, you know, and it is helping us get those $10 and $50 gifts and building that younger donor base. I mean, you know, my director of annual giving or alumni giving, you know, he was embarrassed to tell me that he only got 80 gifts last month through Phonathon. Well, 80 gifts is good. To me, that's 80 gifts. I don't care if they're small gifts. It still kind of lays a foundation, so.
My question is to something that you said a little earlier in your presentation. You mentioned that smaller shops might not be ready for a major gifts officer. So can you tell me what makes a small shop ready for that?
Yes, absolutely.
And how to watch out for that?
I think it's really that the executive director committing to it, meaning not thinking as an executive director, I'm going to hire a major gifts officer, and then we're going to get major gifts. Because usually, especially for a small shop, you have a small budget for a major gifts officer, so you're not hiring someone with that much experience. You're hiring someone with a lot of enthusiasm, who cares about the mission, but they're only going to be able to get those donor prospects to a certain point. So the executive director has to play a key role in that. They have to be going to the lunches. They have to be, you know, personally involved in that fundraising. And if they're not ready to commit the time, just hiring someone doesn't work, in my experience, even if it's the right person for that role. It's got to be a partnership. Yes.
How do you make sure that your donors are friends of the organization versus friends of the fundraiser so that when the fundraiser leaves, the donors leave?
Yeah, that's a great question. I mean, typically, I don't consider it ethical for the, in general, for the donors to move around with the fundraisers. That's not really what the profession of development is about. Now, sometimes we do make good friends who do want to support us in different roles, but I think it's the responsibility of the development person to make sure that those donors are related enough. I mean, they say the more relationships you have in an organization, the stronger relationship it is. It shouldn't just be to the development person. And they really, there are, you know, in particular some consultants out there that kind of promise you, if you hire me, I'm going to bring so-and-so and so-and-so. That's not ethical. That's not how it's supposed to work. They're supposed to, you know, a true ethical fundraiser is going to make sure that the donor is committed to the organization, in my opinion.
How do you work the relationship with board members so that they're involved but not interfering?
That's a great question, and I meant to touch on it as it related to events. I mean, keeping board members focused on revenue generation, on development, you know, so as it relates to events, you know, the women that pick the centerpieces on event committees, it's kind of not the point. The point is, how do you bring the sponsors in, you know, and so, I think part of it is the culture of the board, and if you have a board chair and a president, that your board chair and your president should not allow the board to meddle in operational things that aren't helpful to the institution, you know, but the development person can just be consistent about, this is what I need help with. I need you to introduce me to this person. I need you, you know, all of this other stuff. Is that kind of what you mean?
Yes, but I can see where board members would be interested in helping with the case study messaging.
Oh, yes.
Some of the other
but
activities.
That's actually a great tool to get them involved and to get buy-in of the trustees as donors. We've had a lot of input from our board. In particular, we had a subset of the board, a campaign planning committee, but they were all board members. We spent a lot of time with them refining the case. But we picked those committee members based on either their capacity to make big gifts or to introduce us to the big gifts. And so their feedback really was about fundraising, even though it may have been wordsmithing and whatever. We were still sitting with them in their homes talking about how to raise money for the institution. So just making sure you use that to the institution's advantage. I know they do want to. They do want to do that, but at some point you have to cut it off. I mean, there are certain, you know, at a certain point you do have to say, this has been really helpful, but now we've got to print this and start actually raising money. How much do you see yourself giving? That's how you turn that around. Then they stop calling you back. No, I'm kidding.
Last question over here. Can you
hear me?
Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit more about your last campaign and the impact that you, in your strategic plan, you're planning for that?
Yeah, so, well, it's interesting because that project came about, it's not really what we expected within our strategic plan. We were growing as an institution, and we knew we needed more dormitory space, more classroom space, all of those things, but we didn't know that all those needs would manifest itself in this huge building that we would then have a huge campaign for. And actually, the timing of the strategic plan was such that once we had the building for maybe only a year, we were writing a new strategic plan. So I don't know. The strategic plan didn't say we're going to find a huge new building and, you know, engage a middle and high school partner and launch a graduate program. I mean, it did say we're going to explore launching a graduate program. We know we want more residential students, but it was kind of a fortuitous. I mean, to a certain extent, it was just a fortuitous situation that we had a trustee who managed property for General Motors. They happened to have this huge building that they really wanted to get rid of, right? And we had the need, and they helped us do the due diligence, which took a year. We spent trying to figure out if it was right for us. So it wasn't completely aligned with the strategic plan, although it was the building itself, although it did fulfill our objectives, just not in any way that we envisioned.
Yeah. Hey, unfortunately, I know we've got a few more questions, but maybe Nina will answer those after
sure.
Here. I want to thank everybody for coming today. Nina, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Great.